Dear students, this time rats racing against time for students in pathology welcomes you with two short topics, one of which shall be exfoliative cytology. The importance of it is given in the enclosure over here. It can be a short note by itself or part of a long essay. What does the term exfoliation mean? It comes from the Latin word. The foliage means leaf and exfoliate means falling off. So look at this tree, which is given as an analogy. The leaves are being shed off. Similarly, you find that there are cells constantly being shed from the various surfaces of our body. These, particularly from the FGT, female genital tract, the lung, kidney, urinary bladder, gastrointestinal tract, etc., are used for the study of the pathology in those regions. First, we shall go to sputum cytology. So whenever you are asked a question, I would like you people to kindly have a panel of subheadings. So what can be the significance of sputum cytology? From this, we can diagnose various inflammatory disorders. It can be acute inflammation or chronic inflammation. Sometimes specific diseases such as tuberculosis, I might see a giant cell. Fungal infections such as Candida albicans, histoplasmosis, etc. can be identified. Metaplasia, malignancy, dysplasia, etc. can also be identified from the sputum cytology. Rarely we do see something like this. It is a dumbbell shaped structure which is called the asbestos body, found in a disease called asbestosis. And we can also see Kirschman spirals, as in the case of bronchial asthma. This is again the lung cytology. Normally, I find that the lung is lined by ciliated columnar epithelium. I hope you people are able to make out the cilia in this region. It is used for brushing away the fine particles that enter our lung. But on the contrary, this is also from the lung. I find that the cells are large. I am able to see a large nucleolus. And they are all arranged together in a glandular configuration, which means it is an adenocarcinoma. Increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, glandular configuration. So this can be identified. So also squamous cell carcinoma, etc. This again is the sputum cytology. In this case, I am able to find that there are broad aseptate hyphae that can be diagnosed by means of a silver stain called the May-Grunwald Jamsa, and it is mucormycosis. These are all opportunistic infections which can occur in our body. And this is a pseudo hyphae. It is not a true hyphae as in this case. It is a pseudo hyphae which can be seen in a disorder called as Candida albicans. This is also a fungus which has got a figure of eight appearance, or it divides by budding. But when it is in a very congenial atmosphere, it can grow into long hyphae-like structures, which are called as pseudohyphae. Another region where the cytology is useful is the female genital tract. The female genital tract, it consists of the vagina over here, and this is the cervix, and this is the lip of the cervix. And samples can be obtained. Look at the shape of this particular one. This is called the Ayer spatula, and it is attached at the site of the lip of the cervix, and in a clock-like motion, it is moved around so that the samples of the cells are all attached to this. So this is also a diagram of it. This particular diagram you people can draw very easily. This is a uterus, and this is a cervix, this is a vagina, and you find that in a spinning motion, the sample from the ectocervix and the endocervix are obtained, and smears of these are made. Now, what can be the use of the cervical or the cervico-vaginal cytology? It can be study of infections, again, non-specific infections or specific infections, as I shall be showing you. Inflammation, hormonal status, whether the patient is in the estrogen phase or the progesterone phase or in the atrophic phase. These can be studied. Metaplasia and dysplasia, any epithelium, you people can remember this. And atypical cells, sometimes it is called as unknown malignant potential. Atypical cells with unknown malignant potential or a frank carcinoma. I would like you people to kindly prepare this list and retain it for the answer. Let us see what I've got in the picture. So this is a pear-shaped organism in which I'm finding the nucleus, and then there is a flagellum. Paraflagella can be seen over here, and it is a Trichomonas vaginalis, which is a parasite that can be seen in the vaginal smear. Also, these cells are called the intermediate cells, and these are increased in a condition called as pregnancy. In pregnancy, sometimes they are all folded in a boat-like configuration. Look at this particular cell. It is folded, and they are called navicular cells. Navicular cells, which can be diagnostic of pregnancy. So that also we can include in the list of diagnosis. As we had seen in the sputum, here also we can see malignant cells. Look at this one. These cells are all large. There is an increased nuclear cytoplasmic ratio, and the nucleus is also large. And the cells are all elongated, and they are called as tadpole cells. Strongly diagnostic of malignancy. So look at the various conditions which can be diagnosed. I repeat once again, infections. They can be non-specific or specific. If it is going to be specific, it can be Trichomonas vaginalis or Candida albicans. Hormonal status, estrogen phase, progesterone phase, etc. Or it can be pregnancy, where we can see the navicular cells. Atrophy when the lady is old. And any epithelium, we can see this metaplasia, dysplasia, and atypical cells. Initially, it is unsignificant malignant potential, but later on, it can become a frank carcinoma. And this is a normal vaginal smear. In a lady, when you obtain a smear, you find that there are some pink-colored cells with dot-like nuclei. They are called the superficial cells. And there are blue-colored cells with slightly larger nucleus, which are called the intermediate cells. Some cells can be very small. They are called the parabasal cells, as in this case. And it is a normal vaginal smear. And this is the air spatula, which is used for obtaining the samples. What are the pros and cons of this exfoliative cytology? For one, it is a non-invasive procedure. We are not injecting anything. We are not taking a biopsy. It is an outpatient procedure. The patient can be admitted to the OP room and then discharged within a few minutes. It is of a short duration, relatively cheap. Not much material, manpower, or equipment is needed. It can be repeated if required. The disadvantages are it is not 100% accurate, only 80%. And it has to be correlated with the clinical condition. The expertise is needed at the level of the pathologist, at the level of the clinician, and at the level of the technician. So all the three are important. If the sampling is not adequate, the report is wrong. If the clinician does not offer a good description, the pathologist finds it difficult to proceed. So these are the advantages and disadvantages. These you people should mention. And sometimes we can prepare what is called as a cytospin or a cell block. And if it is only 80% accurate and suspecting a malignancy, later on a biopsy also can be done. So I would like you people to kindly write a good answer on cytology. It can be FNAC, which is a question, or it can be exfoliative cytology. You people will have to write both. And what are all the stains that can be done? The Papanicolaou stain, HNE, Leishman stain, May Grunwald GMSA. And this is the May Grunwald GMSA, one of the Romanowski stains that has been used to stain the cells. The next one is the fine needle aspiration cytology. It is of paramount importance both in the clinical practice as well as in the examination. The significance is given over here, and in surgery it is of great significance. Always you find that there are a lot of subheadings that we will have to remember. Cytology means it is just a study of cells. It can be exfoliative cytology that we had seen earlier, or it can be from the body fluids, sometimes from solid swellings I aspirate, which is called as fine needle aspiration cytology. Imprint: when I cut a specimen, I just apply the slide, I get some cells, which is called imprint. Guided is when I use an ultrasound to go to the particular site. And FNC means fine needle cytology, no aspiration. And bone marrow aspiration is another area in hematology where you use the aspiration for cytology. So you'll have to think of all these things. Always I used to say, think of the subheadings will take you to the answer. What are the indications for the FNAC? What is the apparatus, procedure, precautions, stains, interpretation, advantages, disadvantages, pitfall, and alternate procedure. Even if your answer is going to be small, break it up into subheadings. It will help us to answer the question better. As I mentioned earlier, it is a teamwork between the clinician, the pathologist, the technician, and the radiologist. What are the common sites from which we can do an FNAC? It can be a salivary gland, lymph node, thyroid, breast, subcutaneous mass, neck swellings, etc. So what is common to all these things? How do I remember this entire list? What is the key? They are all superficial and accessible masses. So remember this, you'll be able to recollect this entire list. Also, it can be deep-seated mass. Is it clear? And when I go to an unknown place, I need a guide who will be able to guide me. So this is called as guided aspiration. Guided aspiration. Retroperitoneal, I want to do, I will have to do a guided aspiration, ultrasound guided, etc. And this is the aspirate instruments. This is a syringe, an ordinary syringe. It has got a barrel, it has got a piston. This black colored one, and lower down is the piston. When I pull this back, there is a negative pressure that is being created. I can do it with bare hands, but sometimes some people attach another loop over to it so that it is used for pulling it back, creating a greater negative pressure. This is well brought out in this particular instrument over here. It has got the shape of a rifle, so it is called an FNAC gun. So this is as though you are going to pull a trigger. It is attached to the piston, and a negative pressure is created in the barrel of the syringe used for aspiration. And these are the various needles. Depending upon the depth, you people can choose the needle. And look at the procedure. So you will have to obviously reassure the patient, make the patient feel comfortable, cleans the particular site. So there will be a lot of dirt and bacteria in the patient as well as our own hands. So we are supposed to wear a pair of gloves, clear the site with spirit, and then fix the nodule. Fix in the sense, look at these two fingers. There are two hands which are acting. In this hand, I am fixing the swelling. So between the two fingers, so that it does not move around. Otherwise, it will slip under the needle and the aspiration will not be proper. After fixing it, I perform the aspiration. I pull the trigger and the material gets collected in the needle and a small amount in the barrel. I express it onto the slides and make smears out of it. The slides can be either air dried or they can be put in alcohol. Later on, a staining can be done. So I hope with this alone, you people will be able to explain the procedure. So this is a nodule over here, and the needle is injected, after which the piston is pulled back, negative pressure is created. I move up and down or in different directions so that better sampling is obtained. Finally, the syringe and the needle are withdrawn, it is removed, again reattached, and the contents are expressed onto the slide. So this is called as fine needle aspiration cytology, because I am doing an aspiration. Sometimes I'll just be pushing the needle inside. There is no syringe at all, going in different directions, and the material goes into the needle by means of capillary action. And that is called as FNC, fine needle cytology, without aspiration. What are the stains? Just like the exfoliative, you have got the Leishman stain, MGG, Ansetra stain, Pap stain, and the hematoxylin and eosin. And these are the methods of making the smear. It is expressed, and using another spreader, I am able to make multiple smears out of it. So it is a highly technical one. You people can see there is a difference between the left and the right. On the left side, it is a good smear. The cell morphology is well retained. Whereas here, it is haphazard, not clear at all. It has got too many artifacts or something that I have created. So this should be avoided, and smears should be as good as this. This is an aspirate from the thyroid. I am finding it is having a pavement-like pattern that is classical of colloid. So in colloid goiter, this will be the appearance. And some of the swellings, the fibroadenoma in a young lady, you find a good aspirate can be obtained. We can make a diagnosis. This is a histological counterpart of it. Later on, you people will be able to understand this one. What are the advantages of the FNAC? Cost effective, outpatient procedure, minimum trauma, rapid diagnosis. It can be repeated. There is no scar mark, etc. So if at all it is necessary, it can be repeated. There are some limitations and complications. Accuracy, I will have to hit the site, the material has to be obtained. A little bit of technical expertise is needed. Sometimes complications such as hematoma or a blood clot. I should not make the patient stand and do an FNAC. He will go into fainting. Better make the patient lie down or at least lean against a support. Infection, not to the patient but to the pathologist. If the patient is going to be a HIV positive, there is a good chance that the pathologist can be affected by it. Also, I should not have a tendency to over-diagnose or under-diagnose. Rarely I find that it will be non-representative. So please do remember this picture in the background. So this is a barrel, and this is a piston, and this is a needle, and this is a swelling as such. Even this particular diagram you people can draw very easily. And the basic necessities are some amount of concern. I should behave like a clinician, a good clinician. Compassion is needed. Basic knowledge of the lesions in that particular sites. I should also be aware of the limitations. A little bit of imagination is needed. For example, if it is going to be moving only in one direction, then it is probably attached to some structure such as the nerve. Therefore, it can be a neurofibroma or a schwannoma. And I will have to correlate with the basic clinical detail, whether it is rapidly growing, slowly growing, etc. Gracias.